Hey guys, it's Jordan here. I figured I'd give you a quick update on everything that I've been working on lately and some new projects. On the ground here, you might notice that this is a original Pontiac engine. It's blue. I'm sure some of you have seen these before. It's got an Edelbrock intake, a Holley carb. It's been adapted to HEI. This is not going in the Trans Am. It is going in my new project, which is right behind you. Just got this in the day. It's a 68 Pontiac GTO. It's in rough shape. It's not, it's definitely not finished or close to being finished, but I like it. I saw it on Craigslist. I thought it was really cool. It was a good deal, and I couldn't sleep that night. I was thinking about it, and now it's here.
This one came from Springfield, Missouri. And that 400 on the ground back there, the engine and tranny are both the original engine and tranny for this car. And it is a true GTO, not a Le Mans. We ran the VIN and everything, of course, before we bought it.
It's already titled in my name. I got plates for it. Not that I'm going to need those for a little bit. But yeah, we figure you guys might like an update.
One thing that's pretty cool, we think, some people like the Hideaway headlamps, and these had the same exact grills as the Hideaway cars, but this is a non-Hideaway car. Those are fixed position headlights. I actually tend to like these more, but each, you know, everybody has their own taste.
And for me too, this is my favorite. The Hideaways, when they're open, they actually look like they're missing trim above.
Mm-hmm.
I personally like this. I'm going to black the grill out though when I paint it all, but go ahead and show you the non-existent engine. Okay guys, we got the hood open. That was a pain. Turns out there's no hood hinges on the car or on the hood, but it is up now, and as you can see, pleasantly surprised, it's not trashed. The firewall looks good, the wheel wells look good, the frame, and over there on the firewall you can tell that somebody had been working on it recently, and the guy had said that it ran and drove not too long ago, so I'm kind of believing that.
Even the battery tray is not like rusted out or anything.
No.
It's actually pretty solid.
There's only, the only rusted out part I saw is this right here where the radiator would mount.
Mm-hmm.
But that's like easy stuff to fix. It's not bad.
If you look at that number right there, 68 is the year, -24237. If you look that up, it'll tell you that it is a real GTO. And then you have the build date and everything. Then over here, there's a paint code, L and F. Earlier when we looked it up, that's how we figured out that it was supposed to be a Lucian blue, which is like an icy blue color. Pretty
cool. It's a cool looking color. There were better colors, but it's pretty neat.
It does have the PMD wheels on there, you know, the rally wheels. Still has the 6.5 liter badge there.
Now the difference between this year is this one has a vent window, whereas the later ones did not.
Right.
I personally, because it's a non-AC car, I would rather have the vent window.
I know they might, cool.
They might look cleaner without that, but I don't think it hurts it really.
No. And it does have the original seats in it. They're pretty rough, but the structure's there if you really wanted to make it how it was, you know. It does have the original gauges, and they're pretty dirty. Maybe Jordan can wipe them off, but it's got the correct 120 mile per hour speedometer there. Yeah, I think it's showing about 36,000 on the odometer, so obviously probably 136. But all that, you know, wood grain dash and everything's still in there. We'll just have to see how it cleans up.
I'm probably gonna, tonight, I would like to get the hood patched up where there's a rust hole right here. I had originally thought it was from a hood tack, but the hood tacks actually sit more around here.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm gonna just chop this clean out and then weld a patch panel in. And then I'd like to just completely knock all of the rust off of that and get it in some form of sealer.
Yeah, get it protected.
Just to keep it from doing it. This was originally a vinyl top car. I like vinyl tops. I'm probably going to get rid of it on this. I know some of you are going to hate that sentence, but the good news, some of these vinyl top cars, most of them, tend to rot right here where this trim goes, and this one did not. It's a little crusty, but there's no giant holes. The typical GTO rust point it does have inside of this window lip, because it's sunken down into it, kind of flush mounted. Mm-hmm. They rot out. This one's got a little bit, but actually not as bad as I've seen it.
Mm-hmm.
I can definitely fix that.
You can see a little rust on the package tray there, but you know, that can be fixed pretty easily.
and the trunk. The trunk is pitted bad, but like right here is the only real problem area. And I could cut that out and fix that if I want to keep the original trunk. Yeah. Not so pretty side.
Well, over here, somebody started doing a little body work, years ago.
And you can tell it looks like they didn't hit anything with it too bad, but there was they just tried to cover up the rust with filler, which that doesn't work. You should never do that.
All the glass is in the car all the way around. It's not the greatest, but all the side glass is good. The front and back look, they're starting to delaminate, but
yeah, actually it came with the new rear glass.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna throw that in it too.
Yeah, that's an original 68 window there.
I can't wait to call Safe Light and ask them to replace this, but that's gonna be a while later. Yeah, actually this might surprise some of you too.
Mm-hmm.
The door looks trashed. There's actually no rust going through the door, and this is the only door that opens, but look at the rockers, or the seal.
Yeah,
look at the sill.
The whole sill of the door is good. And look at that back floor pan.
Good.
Solid.
The front floor pans, they've just got typical holes. Like,
there's just a little bit up there where the tunnel meets the floor.
Yeah.
And you can buy all that, you know.
Oh, yeah. But I think I'm going to be able to buy sheet metal and just hammer it and dolly it into that general shape and patch it up.
Mm-hmm.
I want to do a good job on the floor. But, stay. I'm happy though. It is cool. I don't know. I think, you know, when you get something new, it takes a little bit to set in. It is neat. I've wanted one of these since I was a little kid. I love these 70 Chevelles. I like a little bit of everything. Fairlanes and Paulas, but yeah, I love this. This is gonna be cool. This is gonna be cool for our channel too.
We were gonna not buy any more cars until we finished this other thing we're working on. but anyway, you know how stuff happens. When it pops up. You pass something by, you never get it, you know.
I couldn't sleep that night that it popped up. I've been waiting for this to get here for about a week now. The guy actually delivered it, which was awesome.
There's something cool about it. That's all original metal. You can look at the rear quarters. It's never been messed with. You know, so that's pretty neat.
I don't know. Look how hot it is.
Yeah.
By the way, you can like look at just like evaporate like immediately, just nothing.
Yeah, it's crazy.
I touched the trim on it and like burnt myself. That's why I was wearing gloves.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's weird. I couldn't sleep that night when I saw it on Craigslist down there. I got real bummed when I noticed how far away. I know that doesn't seem far away to a lot of you, but to me it is.
It was 4 hours each way.
Yeah, that's a lot for me to sit in a truck. I don't like it.
So we didn't. We had the guy bring it.
I'm getting ready to go. Me and my girlfriend are going to Florida, and that's going to be a drive. But yeah, this is exciting. I like this. I'm really happy to have this.
Some people look at it and be like, wow, that's a piece of junk.
Yeah,
but to us, we're like, this is way more solid than we thought.
I was expecting to buy a Vintag with some Swiss cheese attached, but...
And honestly, like, there's just no fear with us because either we can fix it or we know some people that can fix it. The guys at Mans can fix anything if we get stumped, you know?
They're all real cool. I know. Yeah. I could make a phone call and they would at least explain to me how to do it.
So. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, now for the 17th time, we're going to end this video because it's probably like 20 minutes now.
I'm just excited.
Yeah, it is cool.
All right, yeah. We'll see you later. But this was the worst spot on the hood. I chopped that out. I took some sheet metal that I had and I just put in a patch panel here to get rid of it. It's not finished yet. I'm actually out of welding gas. I ran out while I was doing it, so I'll have to finish that up tomorrow. Other than these two holes I have to fill in, I did delete the trim for the vinyl top, because on this car, this all again would have had a vinyl top, and there was this trim that would have kind of wrapped around, came back to here, and then crossed above the trunk and went to the other side too. So I filled in all the little holes and ground down all the little clips for it.
After look, it's already pretty smooth,
so it's all gone. It's, you know, it's going to get reworked 3 or 4 more times before it's, you know, ready for paint, but it's good enough for now. I basically just replicated what I did on that side on this side. I still welded all of the little holes, ground down all the little tack points, tapped it in, put a little bit of filler on it, block sanded it. This right here, which looks really great, is basically to fix a very small little problem that I had. It was just, it had a little low spot. I did that. That's going to get knocked down to something, you know, the size of a hat, like a silver dollar or something. But it's easier to do it that way for me.
That was more of a material problem, not what you did. Yeah,
problem with some primer. We might interject a little clip here, but I actually welded a little bolt to the body of the car as my ground for my welder. I welded a bolt. I cleaned up the metal here and welded a little bolt to it so I could get a good ground so I could weld in these little holes from where the trim was.
Oh, okay.
See, there was a hole right here, but I cleaned it up and then I welded the hole shut. And I'm going to do the same thing right here. Mm-hmm. I just did this so I could get a better ground closer to where I'm actually working. It's a great car. It's a Slayer 750 quick fuel. It's vacuum secondary. It's got an electronic choke, which I don't even have hooked up, but I might on this. Just a really good all-around carburetor. And it is nice and shiny, which I could take relief. But I love these. If anybody was looking for like a, you know, a good carburetor that's like a fair price, this is what I would recommend to you. Yeah, I got some super stock wires. That's really riveting.
Everybody's gonna be like, ugh, XL, but you know,
whatever.
Bottom local.
Yeah, they're from O'Reilly's. I also did order a full Felpro head gasket, everything. Gasket kit.
Yeah, head gaskets, pan gasket, valve cover gaskets, everything.
These feel to be steel core, but you know, Felpro blue stripe gaskets, they're good, they're fine. The rest of the stuff is rubberized cork, which I like, so. And the last, like, super riveting thing is valve covers.
And that's only because there was a little bit of damage on one of the originals.
Damage that I kind of caused getting it out of the guy's trailer. But, you know, they're just, they got a little, how do they put it at Pat's? They got a little flare. They got a couple of little fins
in them. A couple extra little things on them.
But they're basically just stock replicas.
But what we liked about them, here's the originals, okay? You notice everything's in the same place. Yeah. So that's nice. Unlike most aftermarket, then they move them, you know, to right here. So we can run the PCB and the filler.
But, I mean, hey, with this, I'm going to polish the crap out of that intake at my buddy's house tonight, probably. That on there, that shiny new quick fuel, this engine all painted beautiful in Pontiac blue, which we're going to show you here in a second. It's going to be really nice.
Jordan painted the oil pan, probably a little prematurely, but he couldn't wait to see the color.
Yeah. It's all covered in body filler dust now, but this is the color that the whole engine is going to be. Minus the dirt.
Honestly, it's one of the best engine colors of all time.
It's
a light blue metallic, so there is metallic in there.
I don't know if you can see how much metallic, but there is a lot of metallic in it.
Once the engine's done, we'll pull it out in the daylight so you can really see it, but it's pretty awesome.
My girlfriend brought me some pizza, and I was just out here messing around with stuff, and I kind of slapped the lock down, and then I pulled the lock back up, just messing around to show her that it was broke. And ironically...
Started working.
Oh, and by the way... Listen to that silence. No squeaks. I sprayed a little bit of WD-40 on it, and it's like...
Look how good it shuts.
Like, amazing.
Yeah, like a new one. Look at that.
You should hear my Trans Am door.
It's like...
It's terrible.
Way better.
Yeah, that's some...
And the only reason you hear anything at all is because actually this one fender is misaligned, but he's got to cut that metal out anyway. But once that's all set up and correctly aligned, it's going to be smooth as butter, you know?
Oh yeah, I did spray some WD-40 back here too. The window mechanism for the back's working now on both sides.
By the way, the window mechanisms on these are so cool.
It like kicks, yeah, like a weird...
It's a dual action motor, or gearing system. It kind of goes back and then tilts down and comes forward again.
Yeah, it like throws it three ways.
It's pretty cool.
Hey guys, how's it going? I'm eating Rice Krispies treats and working on the GTO. Made two interesting discoveries we thought we would share with you. First of all, I pulled a fat baggie of weed out of a rust hole in the front bumper. Second of all, somebody has drilled a light bright of Frosty the Snowman fishing in the fender of the car. So we're going to show you that now.
You might think we're kidding, but we're going to pull the light out and see what you think on your own.
Now, the big light behind it, sometimes it'll kind of throw it off a little bit, but from certain angles, that looks a lot like Frosty the Snowman holding a fishing pole to me.
Yeah, you can see the, right here is his, like a big hat, top hat. There's the fishing pole, and there's his body, and then arm.
I have a theory about that bag of weed in this particular drilling arrangement.
We find it hard to believe that whatever body damage was going on would necessitate this particular sequence of holes. I have no idea. I've never found anything quite like that.
I did actually also patch the hood. That was a fun time. The metal here wound up being pretty bad. It's probably laying around here somewhere. I don't really feel like digging around for it, but there was a huge hole right here, and then the metal behind it wound up being really brittle. Couldn't really weld to it. Had to grind it in. I cut a chunk out about that big, I would say. Pretty good piece. And then I welded in a new piece of sheet metal. Just got it back to where the metal wasn't so corroded and shot. And then the new piece welded really nice to it. Then obviously I ground it down, fillered it, and block sanded it. This is only at 180 right now. The whole hood needs gone over. Got a good dent there. These were little pinholes through the rust. Luckily, the metal around it actually wasn't that bad, so I just tacked them closed and ground them down. The other thing was the fender patches that I mentioned I got in. I went ahead and cut the rusty metal off, as you can see here on the ground. It was in pretty bad shape. And then here's the backside. It was shot pretty much all the way up. Metal is nice and thick up here. This was just some surface rust, but down here, as you can see, it was pretty gone. So I got rid of that and actually used the entire fender patch. I never even trimmed the fender patch. I just cut the fender so I could use as much of it as possible. So it went up actually about perfect. This is where I mated it right here. I didn't fully grind this weld down all the way yet, but up front it is. But these are actually the factory holes for the GTO emblem. So the cut went right there, and then I welded it together, tacked it up, and ground it down. And after I knock this down and, you know, finish it up, put filler on it, block it, it'll look pretty good. I did a little bit of body work, not a whole lot, not really anything worth showing, but this fender, it had never really fit the car right, and every time I would open the door, for one, it would contact this. It actually got really tight right here, so I cleaned that up with a grinder while I was fitting it. I fully, obviously, welded the patch panel. I cleaned all of it up. This is just a rough once-over. There's high build on it just to keep anything from getting into the body filler and so on. So this is all going to be reworked like four or five more times. But you guys probably also remember the Frosty Snowman that was right here. There was like 60 holes drilled in it trying to fix that fender. They're all gone now. I welded all of those holes closed. I ground them down, body worked it. I block sanded the crap out of it about 15 dozen times. And it's finally what I would consider relatively straight. So I worked from there all the way back. I got back here where I put my patch panel in, which was through there. This is not done or even close. It's just, like I said, in high build to keep anything from messing it up, but it's moving along. Behind that, I also had worked on the door today because I wanted to get that fitment just right between that fender, because it was really driving me nuts. Every time I'd open the door, it would make that clanging noise.
Yeah, it was actually tight right there, so it'd rub when it opened.
To fix that, I actually moved the fender forward, because obviously that would be the first thing that you would try. I cleaned up the gap whenever I started to get down here, and I was adding filler for my patch panel. And I also actually, when I had the fender popped off, I kind of hammer and dollied the metal kind of lays back in like that in there, and I kind of hammered it in, which let me get the gap pretty tight against that. So now it doesn't hit it anymore, and it's actually dead silent when you open it. It's one of the it's actually one of the best sounding car doors I've ever had. It's like my Lincoln Town Car. It doesn't make any noise at all.
Hinges are great on it. It doesn't make any creaking or anything.
No, I mean, the most you're ever going to hear is like a light pop out of one of the hinges, and it's very faint. So, I also, like I said, after I got the fitment there right, I went on to the door. The door has been fully skin coated. I took it down to metal. I treated the metal the best I could. And then the door has been skim coated and block sanded. This is in high build too, just like that. The only difference is that needs a lot more work. This is actually ready to be blocked one more time, and it'll be ready for, you know, real primer. This door wasn't that bad though. There was no need to really cut anything out of this. There was no real rust worth mentioning on it. Just some mild pitting, and that's nothing that is hard to deal with. Any of you that might have thought I was going to leave stock manifolds on anything that I own are delusional. I went ahead and bought some long tubes for it. They appear to be pretty good quality. I'm sure like every set of long tube headers I've bought, they'll fit like absolute crap. Mm-hmm. So,
but they've got a good thick flange on them and everything.
Nice thick flange. Real nice long collector here. I like that. That's a lot better than what I've got on the Trans Am, where it's just a little stubby. Mm-hmm. They look like good headers. Got the whole engine painted, as you can see, in Pontiac blue, like it should have been. It looked like they had kind of rattle canned the front of it with some random blue spray paint. It wasn't the right blue. I have one of the long tubes just kind of hanging off of it from some random bolts I found, so you guys could see it kind of mocked up on there. I'm really impressed with how good it looks right now. I love that color on there. This is one of the prettiest engines I've ever had. In the intake cleaned up super well. Actually, I was having a real hard time with it, but Dad recommended some mag wheel polish, like acid, that kind of like etches into the metal.
Hey, go ahead and grab that. We'll show it to him. I don't know if we should, because it's like kind of like advertising, but whatever. It works.
I don't care. But yeah, this stuff right here worked really well. Apparently he had used it back way back when you worked at the truck wash.
Yeah, when I worked at an 18-wheeler truck wash, we used a similar chemical to burn the tanks and wheels to kind of clean the top layer of aluminum off, you know.
But man, I've tried every form of method to polish these intakes up, and this is by far the best. That looks as good as it could look without me actually buffing it.
In fact, I'll insert a photo here so you can see how yellow it looked in comparison, and then you can see what a difference it made.
I'm sure some of you have noticed I have the valve covers sitting on there. These are my new repop ones with the added flare of the little raised fins there. Mm-hmm. Then it's got the quick fuel on it. That's a 750. We've been over this. That's the exact same carburetor that's on the Trans Am. I love quick fuel. These are just comp cams, 152 roller tip rockers. They're not full roller. They have the little pivot ball thing in there. But if you guys have ever watched Engine Masters or read any dyno tests where they compare these to full roller ones, it's a lot more about your actual ratio than reducing the friction. The horsepower difference between these and like a full roller is very negligible. Start, the engine is finally completely bolted together. My carb is on the intake, finally all the gaskets are on. This is actually bolted on. The HEI is now in the back with some new plug wires. I know Excel, but they're fine for now. And it's good to go. The long tubes are sitting over here for it in a pile like everything else in this shed right now. And here shortly I'll be ready to bolt this in. I got those today too. This is like Christmas. But those are just Raystars. They're kind of like knockoff welds. Yeah. But they're really good wheels. I like them.
Pull one up so they can kind of get a better look at the size.
These are 15 by 8 with a 4.5 backspacing, which
Oh, you just had that sitting on there for looks.
But
they're what are they?
They're 15 by 8 with a 4.5 backspace. The reason I ordered the 4.5, because some guys would maybe go 5 on the GTO.
Mm-hmm.
The bolt pattern is actually the same between this and the Trans Am, so these will work on both cars.
Also, the GTO, you could squeeze a 15 by 10 in there.
Yeah.
But the Trans Am, this is it, basically. That's a 275?
Yeah, 275, 60, 15.
So, you know, that's what went into this. It'll still be great for both, but that's all he was going to get into the Trans Am without a lot of modification, you know. All right, guys, Jordan couldn't wait, so he went ahead and threw one of the big tires on the back here so he could get a little visual. He was actually getting ready to patch this lower quarter back here, but since he had it jacked up, why not, huh?
Yeah. We had mentioned in the last video that we were going to clean the shed because it looked like a hurricane hit it down here. It was trashed. And as you can see, we actually did. This looks like a car again, finally. Yeah.
Not like a big table full of junk.
Yeah, there's not 100 spray paint cans sitting on it and, you know, primer and paint cups and whatever, but...
Now you can, like, you know, walk around it. It's kind of nice.
But the main reason for this was I crawled under the car the other night to check the rear diff out, just see what the gears were and so on, and it is crawling with recluses and widows, which is great. Those are the only two types of spiders that we have in Illinois that can put you in a hospital, and I saw about 10 of them under it, so we decided to spray some brake clean and sweep, but now it's a little safer to mess with.
Yeah, we probably can't tell, but we even drug everything out from underneath. The only thing under there now is the exhaust hanging down, but it's all swept out and cleaned out, and he even, brake cleaned the bottom of the car. Everything.
I don't mess with spiders. I don't like them. But I'll hold a daddy long leg. That's about it. But the car actually does look like a car now. I did mate that fender on just to check out the fitment. This is the one that I haven't really messed with it a whole hell of a lot, but this is where the antenna hole was. I welded a patch in there and then coated it and then put some filler down, and it's good. I haven't finished it. And you can see right here, I haven't trimmed this yet. I haven't put any filler on that. I haven't done anything to the inside or this lip right here. Basically, just the face that you see is all I've messed with. It was just a quick once-over to make it look like something. But in the future, obviously, I'm going to clean that up, cut that down so it looks a little better, like stock fitment and so on. But right here, as you can see it in there, is where I welded that patch on. Basically right where this GTO badge goes. And I'm really happy, at least with the face that I have worked on. You would never know that that's where it was. Standing from above it, when I actually slipped this back into the holes, for some reason on my head, it actually, because of the primer line, looked like I welded it up there, but from where the badge is, I know where it goes. But, I'm happy with that, and the other side looks about as good as that. The door gap is good. I haven't cleaned it up at all yet, so it's gonna be better in the future.
And it's not really bolted on there either, is it?
No. But like you can see already, it doesn't hit. Mm-hmm. This door sounds good too, by the way.
Quiet.
Yep, silent.
Wow.
And it already doesn't contact the fender. And once I open that up just a hair more and clean it up and make the edges not look so chunked up, that'll look good. Yep.
Ah. Oh, it's bad.
It's really bad.
Lots of crustiness in there.
Oh,
I see.
It's...
I don't know. I see a railing.
Oh. I mean, I mostly wanted to see the pillars. This pillar over here is a lot better than I thought. Mm-hmm. I was expecting it to be basically gone all the way up on the inside here, and it's really just the bottom like 5-6 inches that I need to replace. Mm-hmm. There's a little stuff on the dashboard, which is no big deal.
Yeah, this side's fixable.
For sure.
Like, even without any kind of special kit, you could fix that.
I can fix that, no problem. This over here isn't, like, great. I mean, it's pretty bad up onto the dash area there, but again, that doesn't really matter. I was going to get rid of that. This is pretty crappy, but again, it's pretty fixable. It does go down into it a ways, but...
Yeah, across the top's good, so we'll take that.
I got the transmission back. This is a 68 transmission. I'm not 100% certain if it's the 68 transmission out of this car, but being a 68 GTO and a 68 Turbo 400 BOP, I would say it pretty likely that
we believe it's the original.
I was told that it was too, so I'm sure it probably is, and the engine is. So, but it has a BTE valve body and shift kit and Raisvestos red clutch packs. You know, Turbo 400s are usually pretty good right out of the gate, and this one actually, when they pulled it apart to rebuild it for me, they said looked pretty good on the inside, so it probably didn't even need rebuilt. But now it's Manumatic, which kind of like the Trans Am, you can put it in drive and it'll shift itself, or I can manually shift it all the time if I want. There's also a torque converter sitting right here for it. This is a 2000 to 2200. I don't remember exactly what brand that is, but if you actually cross-reference the part number, it's a B&M. B&M actually makes these for this company.
Yeah, for various companies, you know.
Yeah, and then they just rebadge them. But 2000 to 2200 will be perfectly fine for that Pontiac engine. It's going to make a lot of torque really low. So there was no real point in stalling it to like 4,000 or anything like the Trans Am does. It's just not necessary. It's a pistol grip quarter stick. It's basically just a regular old quarter stick, but it's got this sweet pistol grip action going on with the fighter jet button on it. And
already got the button
for the nitrous that will inevitably wind up on my car. But yeah, this is pretty cool. However, this kit didn't come with the actual little shell that it goes in, so I bought that from them. They actually had that in stock, so that was good.
Yeah, all this came from Performance Parts Plus in Granite City, if you want to look them up. It's like an old school speed shop, and they got tons of awesome stuff.
Again, we mention them in like every video. Mm-hmm. We don't get paid to mention them. We just really like them.
Yeah, we didn't get anything. Super cool guy. Especially just a cool guy. A good group of people, actually.
I'd like to see that shop be there, because otherwise I would have had to order all of this crap online, and I'm tired of doing that.
It's kind of fun to be able to walk in and grab stuff right off the shelf, you know. Pretty neat.
And then down here, I got a full QA1 tubular coilover set up for the GTO. This is kind of similar to actually what I wanted to put on the Trans Am too, but I never got around to it. This would be the lower. I will tell you, compared to like a factory stamped one, they're pretty heavy. A lot of guys would say that going to this would save you weight and so on. I don't really necessarily believe that to be true.
I'm quite sure it's not true. I think the originals are lighter. Yeah.
But the quality is amazing. And
The welds look great on them. I mean, it's really well built.
Oh yeah,
and I believe American made.
They are.
Yeah,
and then up top it's got bolt-in ball joints, which is easier to change. Mm-hmm. They appear to be good quality. QA1, everything they have is good quality. So, but yeah, all tubular, nice and fancy, and that'll be fun to get on. I am waiting on 2-inch drop spindles. They were supposed to come in the kit. Some mix-up happened, and they didn't quite get it in the box, I guess. But they already corrected it, and I guess Summit is going to be sending that along. So those will be here soon, and then hopefully by then I'm ready to actually start bolting this on, because I need to get on cleaning that engine.
Show them the actual coilover if you want.
There we go. That would be the actual shock that sits inside of the coil spring. And here would be the coil spring. These do, since they're adjustable, I could technically lower the car up to 3 inches just using the coil spring. However, when you do that, they don't ride very good. Hence why I'm going with the 2-inch drop spindle instead. I figure I'll probably drop it 2 inches with the spindle and then drop it another inch with the coil.
Yeah, because actually the guy, one of the guys that works for QA1, said maybe you could go like 1.25 inches and it would keep the ride characteristics and everything. You don't want to go pushing it further than that, even though the kit says it will go more, obviously.
It messes up your spring rate, everything. It throws everything off. You don't really want to do that.
And just so you know, it takes a little bit of math to get everything exactly right, because you can get the springs in 400 pound, 450, 500, 500. Yeah. So you really need to know the weight distribution on the GTO, you know, or
which
on your car.
Which is really bad.
It's like 58% to the front, by the way.
On the front of the car. I also bought a disc brake conversion kit. It kind of came, everything came in together, but it's a Right Stuff brake kit, and then the QA1 tubular kit. So there's my new booster that I got to bolt on the firewall. Luckily, I think they said that was going to be chrome, and it's not, which I'm actually happy about.
Before, it had manual brakes, so there was no booster, and it had drum brakes all around, so this could be a lot better for sure.
Yeah, and then pleasantly surprised, I kind of was expecting single piston, but they're dual piston calipers, so that's nice, and everything is powder coated. All of this.
Yeah, everything is, yeah.
I think these are supposed to be red, but I'll take black. I actually prefer
it'll
black.
It'll look cool anyway.
And I did, I got the drilled and slotted. Now, one thing, this is only the front kit. I'm trying to find just a different rear end for the back, and there was no point in me ordering the back kit, too, if I might find a rear end that already has discs. So if I don't and I end up rebuilding this one, then I'll convert the back
to
discs, too.
Yeah, get a matching kit for the back, basically.
Yeah. But this would be the rotor. They're drilled and slotted, you know, pretty standard stuff, but they appear to be really well made.
And honestly, unless you're like road racing,
this is
the drilling and all that's, you know, overkill. In fact, you're probably losing surface area, but they look cool, you know.
GTO will probably stop better than the Transam does.
And those also will fit inside the 15-inch rims, no problem.
Yeah, that's the other thing. Apparently, you can get them inside of some 14s, actually, somehow. But I think you have to grind on the caliper to actually get them to fit. It also came with adapters. And one thing about this kit is when you put it on, it sits like 3/8 of an inch, I think. Pushes your wheel 3/8 of an inch out because of all the adapters and stuff like that. But
which, in this case,
it needs it.
Is a good thing, because he's running skinnies, and you can see they're kind of deep set anyway right now.
Yeah.
So pushing it out isn't going to hurt anything. You know, make it a little more stable, if anything.
Yeah, it's not going to hurt it. So all in all, I got a lot of stuff sitting here to put in the car, and I've not put a single thing in the car. I have the transmission, I have the torque converter, I have all of the bolts for that. I have a new flex plate over there, and that there's a giant mound of stuff.
And not real exciting, but
yeah, I got a carb bracket for the throttle cable. Woo.
But that means the engine's done.
Yeah, engine is done, other than pulling the carb back off so I can put the plate on it to actually put it in. That was for your benefit.
Yeah.
Doing that.
Well, that, and we thought maybe we'd run it on the stand, but now we're back to just putting it in. So we'll be going from that to that. That should be an improvement for sure.
Woo!
Actually, the lower control arms on these aren't that bad in the factory.
Yeah.
But
just for
see which one's heavier. Pretty close, or
they're close. This might actually weigh a little more.
Huh? Weird.
Yeah, I don't know, guys. I might have to retract. You're talking like negligible amount, but they're very similar.
He's working on the driver's side now, and I don't know if you can see up in there, but he's working on that lower ball joint. And usually what we do is bust the nut loose, the castle nut there, and back it off so that there's a gap, but leave it on the threads. And then what you can do, then you put the pickle fork in there to bust the ball joint loose, and the tension of the coil spring will actually help it come loose. But the nut will catch it, so it won't go too far or come undone and, you know, be dangerous or anything.
There it went.
There we go. That one was not fun.
That was a stubborn one, but as you can see, that castle nut caught it. Now all that spring pressure is on that nut, basically, because the ball joint is busted off the taper. At this point, you got to put a jack under the end of the control arm there, jack it up, and then you take that nut off.
Yeah, I found the easiest way to do this on this car is to just take the upper control arm loose and then pound it out. Get this one, this ball joint loose, get this whole spindle completely out of here with the jack under here, obviously, holding tension on this. And then after that, with the like a little tether or ratchet strap through it, when you run it down, it'll just droop it and it'll come out.
Yeah, because in this case, he is replacing everything.
Yeah.
So the upper control arm, the spindle, and the brake drum can all come out as one.
Yeah.
He can just lift it up out of there while it's on the jack. And then that's out of the way. And then you basically just got to drop it down, and the tension of the spring will pop it down the rest of the way.
All right guys. So the next step is to lunt the jack down slow, not quick. And the coil spring should lose some of its tension. And then at some point it should pop off the seat.
Bang! Oh, I'm just kidding.
And it looks like it did lose all of its tension, so now I'll just get it out of there with the pry bar.
Actually, these springs seem a little worn out.
Yeah, they're stock. 68, been a while, 50 years.
And we got this super long pry bar so you can pry it off the seat there.
Yeah. Kind of tricky to get it up there. There you go.
See, on these, there's not much spring left in them at that point when they're fully drooped.
Now, the reason I use tether instead of chain.
That's a cool watch, anyway.
Yep.
A bit wasteful, but like that was like a four pack for like 10 bucks.
10 bucks, and it's worth not blowing your face off. I didn't check to see if my kit did come with bolts. I kind of wish I had now. Duh, no way. Well, it's steaming, so I guess that means it's good. Saw guys using a... Close that? Yeah, I did. Air hammers and stuff to get some of this loose online. I'm like, oh, good. By the way, if y'all don't know, PB Blaster is flammable, so not recommend covering something with PB Blaster and then hitting it with a torch, because it will definitely light on fire. I have done it. Okay.
Cool.
Part two. That's all gone. Now I gotta get the tie rods and the center link and everything out.
because I'm going to replace all of that too.
Yeah, the tie rods are garbage.
Yeah, the one looks like a banana on the other side. It's screwed. This side's straight, but it's junk, so I'm going to get rid of all of it. Oh, just so y'all can see. Just for the hell of it. See? Unrecommended to use these two things together.
I got the full QA1 tubular front suspension kit on. Upper and lower control arms, 2-inch drop spindles. Along with that, I finally got the disc brake conversion kit on. That is a kit from The Right Stuff. It's a single piston kit with drilled and slotted rotors. Everything has been, I set the preload. It's all been tightened up, torque spec checked, everything. The coilovers are in there. So it's all ready to go. Yeah, so I ordered a new set of Ames motor mounts for it. They should be here tomorrow. Which would give me, if I'm going to rush tonight to bolt my torque converter to my flex plate, bolt the transmission, get everything cinched up together on the ground and have it ready to drop in. I'm going to try to put all of it in as a unit, which you can do on trucks pretty easy, but I've never tried it on a 68 GTO.
Pretty big engine bay, though. I think we can do it.
I don't think it's going to be too bad.
Especially two guys, because we'll get a good angle on it and then get one of us underneath with a jack to lift the tail shaft up.
Yeah, and I have the little leveler and all that, so mm-hmm. I mean, I can change the angle and get it. That's low. It's already low.
Yeah, we're gonna have to jack it back up.
Wow. The car is back on the ground. The suspension is completely done. The brakes are done, other than you need to put some lines on. But yeah, man, it's probably got a good 5-inch drop on the front end right now, and I like it. It looks really mean.
Yeah, those are, of course, the engine's not in there yet, so it's going to drop it even lower, and then he may have to bring it back up a little, we'll see. But
I'm figuring the engine will probably lower it an inch or two, and I'm probably going to have to put a couple inches back into the coils, but boy, it's really angry looking right now. The back tire tucks real nice. I like that. It fits real well and feels the wheel well.
Pretty common for these GTOs to kind of sag down the back, which actually... Yeah. Now that the front's lowered, it gives it a mean look. It really does.
Yeah, it actually has a little bit of rake to it. Mm-hmm. And 2 weeks.
I don't know if you can see on video, but that cross member is, not too far off the ground at this point.
I did get my ProForged tie rod and kit in. The center link's in, the idler arm is in, the tie rods, the sleeves, everything is on. The car's got a very janky alignment right now, as far as like its toe in, but. It's good enough to roll it around and get it on a trailer so I can get it to an alignment shop when it's time. But man.
Yeah, already looks pretty mean.
Yeah, I'm happy with it. I'm glad to have all that done so the car can at least sit on the ground for a couple days.
Yeah, just for, it doesn't hurt to just keep doing it. Just want to be sure, because if you ever don't get it in, it burns the pump up. Well, it also won't move. You can, it looks like
it.
Yeah, see.
This thing, man.
I know, it's not a very good cherry picker.
Good lord.
Scary,
man.
Yeah, no.
This thing, like, has
to try having your arm in here. All right. Oh, you're good. You're good.
We're getting there.
No, it's fully clear of the tunnel. It needs to go back forward into it. Yeah, the cherry picker needs to go forward. All right, guys. Dad's putting the driver's side motor mount in right now. I got this side in, had to tap it with a mallet to get them to go through, but the motor mounts are actually all put together now. Wow, that was a really well-formed sentence.
Did you put your washer on?
I put it on the bottom of the line, but whatever. I did it that way.
Arguably the stupidest way you could have done it.
Well, depends on how good your frame is.
It's not very good. I think I bent it with a jack.
I'm probably not going to do a great job of talking because I'm about to fall asleep standing, but I'll do my best. For starters, that is in the car. That is a big step. Not only is the engine in the car, but the transmission is also in the car, as well as the driveshaft. So the entire driveline is actually in and bolted together. Technically, if this fired up, I could hook the shifter up and, you know, putt it along if I wanted to. I painted the driveshaft up. It looks pretty good. The U-joints and everything look good on it. The transmission is bolted to the crossmember.
Everything. The headers are on. That was a big one.
Headers are on. By the way, headers. Some of you said that that was a nightmare. It is a colossal nightmare. You were correct. that sucked. It really sucked. That was... Oh, my God. I actually almost threw them away and put manifolds back on it, and I am not a manifold guy.
I will tell you one thing. Don't think you're going to do it without jacking the motor up.
Oh, God, no. No, you absolutely have to do that. It took... And he helped me. On the Trans Am, I could yank mine, and they suck too. I can yank mine in about 20, 30 minutes. This thing took about 5 hours or more with two of us. I laid under this car for about 4 hours straight.
With a torch and a hammer and...
And a cherry picker and a floor jack and, yeah.
He did manage to get the driver's side header on without jacking the motor up at all off the mounts.
That one went quick.
Wasn't too bad. But then the passenger side, which looked more open...
In fact, isn't.
And it was a pain until you jacked the motor up, and then that made it a little easier.
I also thought I was going to have to relocate my oil filter, but luckily, I'll tell you, if you go to do it, the oil filter, whatever you would call that, like I said, it's late, but anyway, if you look at it, there's three bolts, and you can pull it off where it actually bolts to the side of the block, and it comes down, kind of like a little spout, and your oil filter would screw to it. Take that off. If you're going to go to do it, just take it off the side of it, put a new gasket on it, and stick it back on. You are going to have a nightmare trying to get that header in if you leave that little piece.
Yeah, I can't see it happening.
You won't be able to do it. I mean, you might be able to do it, but you're going to hate life. So, I would pull that. Obviously you could yank the dipstick tube. I didn't actually have to do that. I just took the little end out of it. Yeah, it's not a great time. Any which way you want to put it. The headers even have a slot, in it, cause you have to like thread one of the bolts in through the gasket and then slide the headers forward to make them line up. Also on these, that slot was fine, but I had to dimple that primary tube. Because I couldn't even tighten the nut.
Yeah, when they made the headers, right where the slot is, they bent the tube of the primary tube into the flange too tight, so it was like there wasn't even room for the head of the bolt.
So I had to like torch it with a rosebud and just like pound.
But anyway, that's headers for you. We've never had headers bolt on.
They basically fit as well as any set of headers I've ever put on any other car. Yeah. Just slightly worse than everything else. That's enough complaining. For the next bit, I put the radiator in, finally. I had to build little standoffs, like little cups with rubber isolators on my tubular piece that I made for the core support. And it actually lined up perfectly. This is the factory plate that would hold it down with a little rubber isolator.
It's got the rubber right in here.
And it works really well. I'm really happy with that. I'm really happy with how it lined up. I think that radiator will be great for this engine. I know Pontiacs kind of tend to run hot, and hopefully that's a 3-core or 4-core. I don't really remember. But it'll do better than stock. So, and I'm going to put a big whopping electric fan on it too, just to give it the best chance possible. But... real quick, while the car is in the air, we could show them the suspension, because my front end is finally completely done. This has been pretty much the slowest moving part of the car. just getting all of this lined out, it was very time consuming. But as you can see, the lower control arms, the upper control arms are on, the spindles, disc brakes, all my new steering kit, the idler arm, the center link, my tie rods, my sleeves. I even got new bushings and stuff for my sway bar. The headers are poking through.
Yeah, new end links for the sway bar. I mean, everything.
I mean, it's all brand new. The coilovers are in. The only thing left to do would be to run lines, like hard lines, and then put the little ends and actually connect everything together, bleed the system, so on. Obviously, there's no booster in the engine bay and so on, but everything under here, other than an alignment, is done.
Yeah, it's so. All greased and everything, you know.
That, to me, is exciting. I actually like sticking my head under there and looking at it, because I've never even owned a car that had suspension that nice on it until this one. It's cool for me just to look at it, because it looks like, I don't know, I'm way better than a Trans Am. But now I'm kind of questioning the skinnies. I probably could have autocrossed this.
Yeah, it should handle pretty darn good now.
But, you know, it is what it is. That's all really good stuff, though, and I'm really happy with how all of it came together, and it looks great under there, and I hope it handles well whenever I go actually take it out on the road. This whole thing started off with me messing with the pillar, passenger side pillar. It was pretty wrecked. I don't think we really showed that. Some of you guys might have caught it. It was trashed from about here to here.
I might be able to put some pictures in if you give them to me.
I have some on my phone.
Okay.
But it was wrecked. So basically what I did was I cut it along this lip, chopped it all the way to the inside of the car, and then I built, basically made one using my vise and some body hammers, rolled it again, and then tucked it in. There's a seam on the inside of the pillar where it already is welded from the factory, and I basically brought it around to that and then tied it in right there where they had already tacked it up. Just pretty well recreated exactly what they did. Ground it down, and it's good to go now. But after I got that done, I was feeling good. I'm like, hey, that was kind of bothering me. Obviously, you don't want to see pillar rot. That's not great. So I have a little hole over here. I have a plate already on there. Just have to weld it in. I have to cut it down and weld it in. But I was feeling good about that, and I was like, well, I need to go ahead and get this trim off so I can see what's going on with the kind of the window track. This is the upper cowl. I hadn't really looked at it, but from here to here, it was fine. It looked good. My firewall looks great. There's no holes, really. I think there's one really small one somewhere, but so there's no reason to think anything would be super, super wrong. But this piece right here, there we go. This piece would basically be sitting just like that across there. And then the little arms, or the little, I don't know what you'd call these, but these are for the wipers. They would be poking through. It's got a little cutout. This metal looked good. It looked good around those. All of the heads of the screws looked decent. So I didn't expect anything too crazy. I thought, well, if it rotted here, odds are it's fine under that. I was wrong. It was very bad. when I lifted this, I found like a 3-inch wide chunk of metal basically gone from here all the way to the other side. It was disintegrated. Did not exist. It was really roach looking. I think I have some pictures of it. It was just some haggard looking, just bad metal that had rotted away over time. I did manage to get the old one off. I fit the new one, and then I welded it all up, all the way across, drilled new holes where I wanted to put them. This wouldn't be where the factory would have. I think they actually would have been tighter. But I picked a better spacing that I liked, and then put new holes in, welded them across, and then now it's on there. I did actually add a few that I don't think the factory had. Up here, I put a few to tie it in a little more. to the actual body, but you know, they wouldn't have that, but I don't see any harm in putting it in there. I mean, more weld holding it in can't be worse, so. I don't even know what area of the car you would call this, really. But kind of inside here down where the, like inside the fender area is.
Where the door hinges go.
Yeah, I'm sure there's a technical name for it. I don't know it, but this was wrecked. Might be able to find some photos of it, but I basically had to chop off all of the metal down through here, replace all of this. This down here where it kind of ties into the rocker, I had to basically chop it along up here and then cut it out all the way down there and make this little curve. Weld it in, treat it for rust. It was very pitted. I had to, you know, like put fiberglass filler over it on top of all this other stuff just to make sure it never comes back, or at least takes a while. But it's good to go now, at least for the next, you know, hopefully 5, 10, 20 years. Nothing's permanent on metal, but you know, it'll be good for a while. But yeah, that was a pain. I'm really happy with how that came out though, considering how bad it was. I was pretty stressed out when I saw that, but I also did put the floor pan in on this side. I wound up basically cutting giant chunks of it out and then just welded in the big slabs that I needed. Underneath that belt, which is full of wires, that was all gone because it's a low spot on the floor. So I replaced all of the metal under where that little plastic sleeve is. And then the whole front area, basically where your heels would sit, I chopped that all out, kind of to the factory seam, and then put new metal in there too. And the rest of this is in really good shape. There's no rust holes, there's no real pitting on it. A lot of that is factory paint. So there's a little bitty area over in that corner that I'm probably going to chop out and replace. And then I already have a patch panel cut for the other side. I left it out so I can do my transmission cooler lines a little easier. Turns out it's really easy to work on those and tighten them whenever the floor is missing on that side of the car. So that I'm going to put that in tomorrow, though.
As you can see, it is on the ground. If we back up, you can see kind of how it's going to sit, basically, if Jordan doesn't fall down.
Yeah, it was graceful.
But it's got a kind of a mean look to it, you know. It's probably going to come up a little bit because it's pretty darn low at the moment. But should be pretty neat.
All right, guys. So I guess for starters, you haven't noticed, this is actually stuck to the floor now. And it's very firmly there. What I wound up doing was I welded bolts to the actual floor pan, sort of facing upward, two in the back. I think there's one bigger one in the front. And I took some cold rolled steel and welded up some brackets for it that kind of run along the bottom of the actual ammo can. And it holds it very, very firm. It's not going anywhere. The bolts actually go through the bracket and then into the inside of the ammo can and fix it to the floor with nuts. So it's bolted down. It's also very easy to get it actually out of the car if I have to. It's not very difficult for me to get that loose and move it around. One thing I didn't really do on purpose, but it's kind of neat. If you've never played around with an ammo can like this, you can actually pull this latch, and then whenever it tilts up all the way, you can slide this over. So this whole top portion that the shifter is connected to with the button and the switch will be completely removed and out of the way for in here, which makes wiring everything up very easy. If you needed it to be any easier, then just go ahead doing that. So like I said though, you tilt that forward and this whole thing comes loose, slides off from the top. But as you can see, it can't get much easier to actually wire anything than that as far as a center console goes. But that's good to go. Okay guys, we're about ready to try to fire this up. I wired my ignition to my little box in the car, so it's actually going to fire off the switch and the button like I want it to. And as of right now, I have the gas pedal hooked up. It could be a little bit better, but I can do some fine tuning a little later.
You see it's got the arming switch there and then the start button right next to it. And this is the very first time we've tried starting it, so we don't know what's going to happen at all.
It has no coolant, there's no belts on it, nothing. This is just a alligator clip on the HEI to the battery to see if it'll do something.
We just want to see if it'll pop off at all, and then we'll kill it and go from there.
So it actually popped off real fast that time, and that was the first time I've ever tried to fire this motor up, so that's encouraging. It sounded pretty healthy, actually, more so than expected. It's definitely got a more rumpety cam in it than I think either one of us thought. We had looked up the numbers and stuff, and we had seen that it was going to be, you know, pretty good, but it sounds pretty good.
Yeah, it's like a 296 duration cam, so...
But I was kind of like, I believe it when I hear it, you know, but it sounds pretty healthy. So I'm probably going to try it again one more time and then pack it up and go home. Because it's actually really late to be doing this right now. And I'm sure our neighbors do not like it, but, you know, I don't want to hear it. So anyway, I got the alligator clip back on the terminal.
We don't know if we're really getting fuel from our janky fuel system. So it may only fire up for a second if it does. But we'll see what happens. That's a lot of smoke quick. Whew. That thing's got some torque.
It's badass at the end, just the smoke's like...
Look how much better you can see in the shed when it's full of smoke.
Why'd that smoke do that weird stuff?
It's like was slow.
It's like fog. Yeah. That's neat. Alright.
Guys, so I'm down here working on the lower quarter. This part up here I'm pretty happy with. It was really rotted right there, so I wound up having to chop up a little higher than I did on the other side. I typically would like to keep it below the body line right here, but it's no big deal having to go up there. So I went up and then I trimmed it all the way into the lip there. I'm really happy with the fitment right now. I'll be able to butt weld that really easily. It's a really good gap. It's better than the other side, actually.
All right, guys, so I had a little situation with my new exhaust. The header collector was put on incorrectly. So what's happening is it's trying to angle my entire exhaust system on the driver's side towards the floor pan. So what I did was I basically just pie cut the 18-inch extension that I ordered and put a little angle in it. I don't have, you know, two pairs of hands. So what I did was I took a jack handle and kind of shimmed it up with a hammer. It's currently holding the bend in it that I have. I'm going to go ahead and tack that before I fully weld it, and hopefully this will be enough angle that it'll actually correct the geometry problem that I'm having under the car. So I'm going to go weld this real quick, and I will let you know how it goes.
Pipe.
All right.
This is gonna rust no matter what, so there's no point in making them look real pretty. But it won't leak.
They still have a giant sewer pipe exhaust on there for when you put 800 horse on it. You know?
Yeah, I'm going dual 3-inch with this because I'm expecting that to end up with some form of stroker kit from Butler Performance in it, so might as well have this prepared.
Good. Sounds pretty good though.
It's like the Trans Am, same exhaust system. I'm happy with that. sounds a lot less wussy than the neck down reversed 2.5-inch glass packs I had on there. So that's just what I ordered was a 3-inch set of 18-inch extensions right off of my long tubes, and then I put a 3-inch H pipe kit that I welded all together, and then I cut actually one of the straight pieces for the center of the H pipe in half, and I used that to stick my they're basically like knockoff bullet mufflers. They're like Jones full bore, whatever the cheapest bullet muffler I could order was. So they're like really really racy sounding glass packs basically, but it sounds cool. I like it. It's the same thing it's on a Trans Am, except actually a little quieter somehow. Piece is chopped out. It went through it like a hot knife and butter. And not that this is gonna set in here flawlessly, but it'll give you an idea of kind of what I'm going for. It's gonna take a little bit of work to get the fitment right, but this is the new piece that's gonna go in there. There is a piece that's supposed to basically be spot welded to the bottom of this, kind of like a clamshell. I'm not gonna be using that because I'm a hack. This deck lid area here is like $500, and I'm not going to be doing that properly either. So what I'm going to do is chop this out the best I can, replace that with a flat piece of metal, lip it, attach it to this, weld flat thick plate to the bottom of this, plug weld it, which I know, woo, and then clean it up, body work it. You won't be able to tell. This will be very rigid. That will be attached to that, so that'll be rigid too. I'm probably gonna end up tin working a lot of the car anyway, or using aircraft aluminum, whatever I have readily available. So not restored, like I've been saying the whole time. This is not a restoration project really. I'm kind of just building it how I want to build it, even if it's hacky in some ways and in other ways it's not. The trunk pan is in, as mentioned, and it's ready for the fuel cell, so I basically welded in a gigantic piece of metal so I can cut a huge hole in the middle of it. But, whatever. It's better than having giant rust spots all over. As of right now, I have all of the metal patches done as far as major ones. I have a couple of little bitty ones to do that are, about 3 square inches. But I have all of my large metal work done, all of the skinning is done, and as far as that goes, I even welded this panel in back here that I was kind of having a problem with. But as of right now, this is in there. It's welded. I haven't cleaned the welds up. I haven't seam sealed anything, but it is in there. The track is in there. And as you can see, I have my old glass in there, which I'm not going to be using that. I'm going to buy all new glass, at least for the front and the back. But I threw it in there just to kind of for mock-up to make sure it still fits. Yeah, it fits well. There's plenty of room around it for the butyl and, sealer. I also have my trim laying in there, and it's kind of haphazardly taped down right now. But I do have all my trim. It's got one little kind of hitch in it over here. I'll be able to fix that, though. I can actually just push down on it with my fingers, and it goes away. So it's not very substantial. I think even just putting it on the trim clips, and it would probably solve that problem. But it all lines up. I'm happy with it. Like I mentioned in the last video, I built a new package tray for the car out of sheet metal. And really happy with that. It has two to three layers of sound deadener, like Dynamat, on it. And I'm happy with how that turned out. So, considering like a month ago, the trunk was not even in there anymore. That was gone. I had the package tray chopped out. The back glass was out. I could, if it weren't for this little bitty, you know, piece of metal here, I would have been able to walk all the way into my car to where the back seats were and until my chest actually touched something structural. So this is a lot better. And I feel a lot better about the car overall now that all of this metal work is done. It's kind of a relief. I don't think I can run into much else rust at this point. I've found all of it that I think I'm gonna even be able to find. So all I had to do was replace 90% of the car with new metal, and it's good to go. OPG should be really happy with me. They've gotten too much business. For something that's actually fun that I've been enjoying doing for the last couple days, other than doing AN lines, I hate that. I've been mentioning getting that fuel cell, and I finally bought it. I bought a 20-gallon RCI fuel cell. The GTOs came factory with a 20-gallon gas tank, so it's not actually a size improvement over what it would have already had. They came with monstrous tanks, which I didn't know. But I like it a lot more. I think it's cooler. It kind of fits the aesthetic that I'm kind of going for with this car. I mean, it has an ammo can as the console, so I know you purist people are going to absolutely hate this, but luckily you can get over it. So we've done videos on plenty of very beautifully restored GTO judges and everything else. They're cool. I like them. I love them. I love really pretty cars. But I'm going for something different. I have a remove before flight, you know, like parachute clip on there. Which, no, it's not getting a parachute. I just thought it was cool. But I'm really happy with this. I think it went in really well. It took a long time to measure that hole, though, I will say. That was like 3 days of just sitting here with a tape measure. Because what I didn't want to do is go through all the trouble of replacing this entire trunk pan and then cut that hole wrong. That would have been a bad time. I would have been mad. I would have thrown a substantial amount of wrenches across the shop. But as far as this goes too, there is actually room here because on GTOs the plate flips down and the fuel filler neck is right there. With it recessed in the trunk so far, I'll actually be able to kind of buy a little 90 or 45 or whatever is going to line up. It'll bolt here, and then I'll run a big clear hose to that, and then I'll end up putting a filler neck on the outside of the car where the factory one would have been. So I'm not going to actually have to open my trunk to put gas in the car, although it probably will be like this for a year or better because I know how I am. But that is the plan, to have it actually go here with a nice threaded one. If you look under the car, again, you'll notice that it comes out with a 90, and then there's a little bit of AN line. And then it goes to 100 micron filter here. This will kind of sift out some of the big stuff that might get in the tank. And then it goes to more AN line. And then there's about, I don't even know, probably 14, 15 feet going to the front of the car. All tucked nice up in the frame rail when I'm done. Right now it's just held on with some zip ties, but I'm gonna actually use some P-clips to fully install it, which I do have right here. Mm-hmm. But going from that, there's AN line all the way to the front, and then at the front it goes to obviously the fuel pump, which I have a nice Edelbrock fuel pump. It's good for about 600 horsepower, so it's good to go for right now. But this is the stainless braided line. It goes in and then it comes out here to black braided line, and then there's another 40 micron filter there, and then it goes to my gauge and then into the carb. So it's probably a little elaborate for what it has going on right now, but I'm obviously planning on building another engine. Probably end up doing some form of Butler stroker kit, lots of nitrous, something.
Thanks.
Thank you.
I put it up, seriously.
Yeah.
Might pull off for a bit.
You want to put it in the garage?
I drove like that whole time with my turn signal on. Well, good.
Yeah, you're going to get used to that.
I'm like an old man. I'm like you.
That was the first official drive, guys.
Yeah.
And it actually did pretty decent. I mean, the first time he nailed it, it didn't seem as fast. And the second time, it's like something started working better, you know?
Yeah, well, it's got, it's probably got a bunch of crap in the motor. And I have my brakes on that whole time.
Yeah, well. That's the least of your problems.
Yeah, I'd get pulled over for that.
If I got stopped for my bright lights, that would not be the biggest issue I have.
Oh yeah, guys, we put up pictures on Facebook, but we didn't really talk about it.
Yeah, the whole car is wired now.
But the car is completely wired with a new fuse panel, modern fuse panel with bladed fuses and stuff.
Yeah, it's a painless wiring panel. It's got seat covers on it now, so it's more comfortable.
You want to hold this? My hands are actually shaky for some reason.
Hey, man, lay off the drugs, Jeff.
It's probably all the illegality.
Yeah, it's kind of stressful. It has plates on it. They are not universal plates. They are actually for this car. I titled it and everything already, but it's missing some other things that would maybe make it legal. So
yeah, headlights, brights, blinkers, brake lights, everything good. Modern fuse panel down on the floor on the hump.
Dashboard needs cleaned up and stuff, but my roll bar is in there. It's technically a 6-point, but it was a 10-point. I just left some of the links out. I got my covers on my seats. My shifter is working good. The steering wheel is facing a completely wrong direction whenever we were going down the road.
It was driving okay, but the steering wheel is definitely not lined up when it was aligned.
Ooh, my bodywork looks okay under the tree and dim lighting. Mm-hmm. Tell right there.
Oh yeah, back bumper is on. I don't think you said that in the last video.
Yeah, the rear bumper is on. You can see the fuel cell hanging down below it. It's got modern flashers too, so it doesn't flash really fast. It's got a nice normal new car speed to it. And like I said, I got plates, got my stickers, got some other stuff I need to do, but it's all there.
No problem rolling those drag reels off.
No, I was getting pretty ignorant. I have to feather it a little bit because I don't have a rev limiter on it yet, and I don't really want to spin a bearing or, you know, throw a rod.
It wants to pull to 65. Like, it really wants to pull hard.
Well, we shifted at 61.
I know. Like, it does not let up. That's the thing.
Anyway, guys, I don't know what the purpose of this video is. It's mostly just me walking a circle while we yammer on, but
we're just kind of excited because that was the first real drive. Like, that was a few miles, and it felt pretty good. It cruises good. It cruises. We didn't have a GPS on us. I forgot my phone, but
speedometers.
65 miles an hour, 3,000 maybe.
65, 70. It was pretty good. I could comfortably drive this car for probably an hour without getting tired of it, so it's not that bad.
Yeah, it's coming along. It's at least we'll be able to start cruising it now that it's working and everything.
Yeah.
Yeah, cool. Hey, you want to get in and just flip the lights on so they can see them and whatever?
Hey, the brights are actually still on the floor switch too.
Yep, use the original floor switch. And it's on brights right now. And what he did was, you notice the running lights, the parking lights are on with the headlights. That's something they did in 68. I believe in 67 the GTOs didn't do that. But anyway, we just like the look of that anyway. See the blinker working there.
The chime works.
Yeah, you just can't hear it. Cause
no, I can. It's actually making the noise.
Yeah, I know, but I say you can't hear it when you're running it, though. Yeah.
Oh, hey, check this out. This is the only car I have other than my Mustang that has hazards.
Oh, yeah. Here, we'll go to the back. Yeah, see? Everything's working.
Look at that. When I break down, inevitably, I can make sure I don't get hit.
The side markers aren't in there yet. He has them.
Got to get a couple new sockets. They were like really old and crusty, so.
Yeah, I might just buy new ones. I don't know. They're but not too much money.
They are cool on the 68 though, because they look like the Arrowhead and they light up and everything. So
I have to open my trunk with a screwdriver right now because the lock is missing.
That's like $15.
Yeah. Though, yeah. So if I have to fill it up with gas, I have to do that.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's all in there. Hey, the glass didn't come out. We probably went like 80, so. Or 55.
I can't remember. I mean, you may not even know that it has rear glass and front windshield. I have no idea, but...
Yeah, well, it's in there now. It's got a brand new front windshield, and I actually had a new rear glass. I actually had completely forgotten that I had it, and I watched the first video the day I got it again, like a couple weeks ago, and I was like, oh, God, there's a brand new piece of glass sitting upstairs. So
yeah, I went up there, neither one of us remembered.
Put it up there so it wouldn't get damaged, and I completely forgot.
Yeah, we were actually watching the YouTube video. And we're like, wait a minute, there's one in the car and there's one on the ground.
We're both like, where is that?
It's so crazy.
Yeah, I went and dug it up. I had it covered with a blanket so it wouldn't get busted.
It's pretty funny. So that saved a couple hundred bucks, you know?
Yeah. right, guys, so the GTO's been down. As most of you know, if you watched the last video, it had a self-built posse that it has developed over time. I, being too cheap and not really wanting to put a whole lot of money into the BOP 10-volt, I just went ahead and fixed it up the best I could for the lowest amount of money that I could. I put the exact same gears that it had in it again, which is kind of a gamble whether or not those are going to be all right. But I also did a mini spool, and I bought a new carrier out of a 68 Firebird because my other carrier got pretty well destroyed because the cross pin wouldn't come out of the spider gears. A friend of mine took it to his buddy's house, and they ended up using an air hammer, an oxyacetylene torch. It did not want to come out. It broke in three places. So I had to get a new carrier, like I said, out of a 68 Bird. I put my gears on that, and then I put the mini spool in it that I had ordered. And just set it back on the ground. It's got new fluid in it, hopefully it runs down the road. Now, mini spools, for those of you that maybe haven't ever driven a car that have one, they on the street are acceptable. They kind of chirp in tight turns, stuff like that. Sticky tires, weak axles, not really a good combination, but it'll get me by for a little bit until I can put something a little beefier under this car, which is all I really care about. Ideally, this would have a 9-inch or a 12-volt or something like that in it. But for the time being, this will work, hopefully. And hopefully I can tear out of the driveway. You'll hear my tires slipping and screeching all over the place, and that'll be good enough for now. Anyway, see if it runs. Mm-hmm. I haven't actually fired this car up in a while, so not sure if it's going to start real quick.
It sounded better that time backing out.
Yeah. Do you feel it? Yeah.
It's gonna be really annoying.
Yeah. That's on gravel.
Back out at the house now. It did pretty good. I'm actually not bothered by that spool at all. Some guys hate them and they can't handle the little chirping that it does, but for me, I don't think it's going to be an issue. The only time I really notice it is in parking lots below or at around 10 miles an hour. You can kind of hear it slipping a little bit whenever it's going around. The main thing that causes that, for those of you that don't know, is like on a posi differential, it'll want one spin a little quicker than the other whenever you're going around a turn, so it turns smoothly, whereas a spool or like a welded diff that you'd find in like a drift car usually, it's like a go-kart. They spin at the same rate no matter what you're doing, whether you're turning or not, so it doesn't let it slip. So it takes the slip out of the tire. It basically loses traction on the tire and chirps whenever you're going around turns. It's not a big deal, and you don't even notice it whenever you're going highway speeds. We didn't feel it at all.
No, even going through like sweeping curves of like 65, felt fine. Yeah. You don't even notice it.
Now, in the rain, they can be a little dangerous if you're not careful, but even that, if you have decent tires and stuff, it's...
By the way, this has drag radials and no wipers, so
yeah,
rain's
so
not
rain
really...
is not an issue. But yeah, we know other guys that have spools in their car. Your buddy with the Ventura has one, mm-hmm. and that's a pretty stout car.
And it's been that way since high school.
Yeah, 20 years more. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's perfectly fine. I'm okay with it. Doesn't bother me any. Which I was concerned though, because I'm kind of particular about certain things, and I thought that the chirping was going to get on my nerves, but it's really not that bad. And for its longevity's sake, I'll obviously try to not take super tight turns in the car. I'll just do my best to avoid doing that. But
and obviously, it has the power to just slide it sideways if you really need to. Yeah. You know.
But. As far as the rear end goes, right now it is still BOP 10 bolt. It's got factory axles, which is begging for a problem with the spool. I'll probably end up sliding something a little stronger than what it's got in there too. They're bolt-in axles, so. If it breaks one, the car can't just slam on the ground like a C-clip car.
Yeah, your wheel won't come sliding off out of it, you know.
But it won't move, so I'd still have to, you know, trailer it home and so on. It gets involved. But, yeah, I'll probably throw some better axles in it just for the time being. And I would still like to put an aftermarket gear set in this, even though I probably am going to replace this BOP 10 bolt at some point with like a 9-inch or...
Especially if you get the stroker motor built and all that, you know what I mean? You'll need something better.
Oh, yeah.
You're already pushing it pretty hard.
Kind of abusive to things. Mm. Anyway, yeah, everything's kind of going back together. Sure would have been nice if it didn't all break at one time. Probably would have allowed me to maybe put a motor in my other car, but that's how it goes. You can't have good luck all the time.
More cars equals more problems. That's a fact. It's more fun as well when it's all good.
I don't know if you guys are aware of this, but I don't have three car money. I've realized that. But it is what it is. Everything's getting fixed. It's just going to take a little bit, or has taken a little bit.
Oh, man. Hopefully this thing holds up good, because we were kind of looking forward to cruising this thing a little bit this summer, you know, and going to some car meets and whatever. So it's getting a little depressing there.
All right, guys, so some of you have commented in the past that you wanted to see the engine in the car. So I figured I'd show it to you, even though it's filthy right now. I haven't really cleaned it.
It is a numbers matching Pontiac 400. A lot of guys put Chevy motors, LS, small blocks, big blocks, whatever in these. I did keep it a Pontiac. Doing my best to do that, even though they are expensive to build. But yeah, it's a numbers matching 400. It's got a slightly beefed up bottom end. It's stock crank and stock rods, but they're upgraded rod bolts because that's a weak link on the Pontiac motors. And it's got hypertechnic pistons, so they're a little better than stock. Ideally, I'd put forged in it the next go around, though. And it does have a mild cam in it, nothing really radical, just a good torque cam. It shifts around 5,000, so that's pretty ideal for what this is. Above that, the heads, they're pretty much factory heads. I didn't do much to them, but I did take them off and I put new Felpro blue stripes on it, and then I put ARP head bolts all across it, so they're a lot better than what the factory would have
put in there. It's got Comp Magnum roller tip rockers on it.
Yeah, 152s. I put 152s just so I'd know the ratio is perfect, because on a lot of the factory stamped rockers, they could be kind of hit or miss on whether or not they're good. Above all that, it has an Edelbrock intake, and then it's got a Slayer 750 carb on it. It's just a vacuum secondary carb. It's not a double pumper or anything. But I ran that on my Trans Am for a few years now with nitrous, and I never had an issue out of it, so I put it on here too. I know a lot of Pontiac guys are really nuts about quadra jets. I'm not one of them, so I put that on there. Quadra jets are fine. I've seen guys make crazy power on those. I just went ahead and did that.
This one runs great. It fires up. As you can see, it fires up quick and runs great, so no problems with it.
Yeah. As far as the transmission goes, it's a Turbo 400. It's a pretty standard built Turbo 400. It's got a Hurst Outlaw shifter on it with a little button on top for nitrous or line lock or whatever. And then it's got an aftermarket valve body bolting onto it.
I think it's from a place called KRE, if I'm remembering right.
I think it is KRE.
But it's a custom valve body.
Yeah, and then so it's not full manual, but it's right up to it. I can manually control all the gears, or I can leave it in D, which is, you know, basically it'll drive itself. But I wanted to go full manual, but the guy talked me out of it. He said I would hate it.
And it's got the red frictions, I believe. They make the blue race frictions, but there's some issues with those, and the red seems to work better. So, and it holds plenty of power.
Yeah, well, whenever I dropped it off to have it built, he told me that the transmission would easily take like 800 to the wheels, which is more than I intend to ever make on it, so... in fact, there's a chance that this car will wind up with a 4-speed someday or something like that, but we'll see what happens with it. But yeah, pretty standard Pontiac motor. It's nothing really radical. Like I said, mild cam, pretty much stock everything. It's just slightly beefed up. As far as exhaust goes, it has long tube headers on it. They're 1 5/8 primary, 3-inch collector. They're just some cheapy headers. They're not fancy. They're not ceramic coated or any of that, which is why they look like they've been sitting at the bottom of a lake already. But 3-inch collector goes to 3-inch straight tube, straight pipe, and then it goes to a 3-inch H pipe. And then right after that, it goes to 3-inch Super 10 Flowmasters with turndowns right in front of the rear wheels.
Does this one have cutouts too? I can't remember.
No. I'll probably add those later, but okay. I didn't put them on. The Trans Am has cutouts. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it sounds good. I had bullets on it, but it sounded kind of ratty, like a farm truck. And I have bullets on my other car, and I love them, but it didn't really sound that great on this. So I put the Flowmasters on it instead, and I like that a lot more. Also made it a little more pleasant to drive around. There's no overdrive because it's a Turbo 400, so it was a little much.
I'm going to go ahead and hop in and fire it up one more time. See how it starts up.
that, guys, so I don't think I quite needed to pump it like I did. I just had it running, but I didn't think about it since we're filming, so it started a little slower than normal. But yeah, it's nothing really radical. It's pretty standard Pontiac build. Good torque cam, good running motor, and it pulls pretty good. I mean, even with the tall gears and the auto, it still feels pretty peppy. We had some impromptu testing against my 5.0 Mustang, and this did waste it pretty bad. wasn't very close.
This thing pulls real good. I guess the tall gears, but then the high torque. So from like a highway speed up, it pulls real hard, you know. Mm-hmm. It's not bad.
Yeah, from a roll it does do pretty good. But yeah, it's a pretty good motor. I'm happy with it. I'll be happier with it whenever I put a big stroker kit in it with some aluminum heads, but for now I don't have any complaints.
Nah, it does the job. Mm-hmm. And you mean you rescued a car that was laying outside for ages, so... You know.
Yeah, that's one thing to remember before you post complaints on this. This car was owned by a guy that scraps muscle cars. He was going to take all of the parts off of it, cut it up, and sell it to people that were restoring vehicles. It sat outside in a field, and that engine was sitting under a tarp in mud. And it actually had mud in the oil pan whenever I drug it home. So this thing was not getting saved. But yeah, anyway, it's kind of running around now. At least it does burnouts again. It probably was never going to do that again. But... freaking woodpecker.
Oh yeah, we got a woodpecker up here now.
Anyway, guys, thank you for watching and commenting and checking everything out, and hopefully we'll have another cool video coming to you soon. Oh yeah, I guess we're telling them to subscribe now. If you're not subscribed, you should subscribe. Can't talk. Anyway, thank you for watching. We'll see you in the next video. Bye. Ha 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 ha.